Sir Edmund Hillary and Ron Ward were members of an air crew of a Catalina flying boat of the No. 6 Squadron based in Navarro Bay, Solomon Islands during World War II. A recent documentary on Sir Edmund Hillary featured a short scene where Ed and his friend Ron go fishing in a small boat which catches fire and explodes, throwing both of them into the sea. There was, however, much more to the relationship of these two men than could be covered by the Hillary TV documentary. This accident ended the war careers of both the men, and both in their own way went on to great heights in their careers and remained friends for life. They first met in Fiji after they had volunteered to serve with the Royal New Zealand Air Force, which had a squadron of Catalina flying boats commissioned to do search and rescue missions in the South Pacific. The Americans had established a base for amphibious aircraft in Lathula Bay, Suva, Fiji, and Ed and Ron were sent there for training and joined a crew of 10. Ed trained as a navigator and Ron as a radio operator.
This is a picture of our crew. One of the most famous ones, of course, is our navigator, Ed Hillary, in the centre back, and me on his left.
Havalu. Following training, they flew their Catalina to Havalu Beach to join No. 6 Squadron, which had been based there since 1943. They landed in style by holding the craft on hidden coral while taxiing towards the beach, but soon recovered their dignity and played a crucial role in future rescue missions.
Catalina flying boats, or PBYs as the Americans called them, are long-range patrol planes. And we flew around hundreds of small islands. We operated as far north as New Guinea, and most of our work in that area was air sea rescue work.
Ron recorded in his memories that 6th Squadron rescued 84 shot down airmen, something they were all very proud of.
Ed and I built a boat and went exploring and croc hunting on their off days. Generally our pattern was fly one day, stand by the next, when we had to be within a couple of hundred yards of our plane, and the next day was the day off. On the standby day we serviced our boat and had it ready for the next day's exploration trip. One of these proved our undoing when on September 1945, while returning from the...
Ed writes in his book, "Nothing venture, nothing win." One Sunday morning, Ron and I rose very early to take one of the airmen across the bay to the American naval base at Tulagi to attend a Catholic church service. It was a pleasant sunny morning with a fresh breeze putting quite a chop on the sea. Ron and I pumped out the Jolly Roger and filled two tanks with petrol. These tanks were suspended above the engine, and I noticed that one of them was a bit loose, but I didn't bother too much about it. We deposited the young airmen at Tulagi and turned for the return trip to Havalo. We were now heading into a bumpy sea, so I eased the throttle back, but when we reached the lee of Palm Island, the sea was flat calm, so I opened up the throttle, but soon, when we emerged from the lee of the island, we hit waves with a succession of mighty thumps. The next moment, there was a loud crack behind us, and a sheet of flame shot through the holes around the engine compartment. The petrol tank had broken loose. The fire was well beyond our control, and Ron and I had been scorched already, and we knew we had to bail before the other tank exploded. I yelled at Ron to jump, and I fell back onto the engine covers. I wasn't wearing a shirt, and I could feel my flesh sizzling, and the pain was considerable. I had just enough energy to roll off the engine hatch and into the water. The Jolly Roger charged on for another 100 feet and exploded in a great sheet of flame. Ron was not as badly burnt as Ed. He was in great pain and in danger of losing consciousness. They were 500 yards from the shore, but eventually made it to an island where they walked backwards in great pain, trying to keep the sun off their burns. A couple of American sailors found them and took them by boat across to Tulagi Naval Base, where they were taken to the base hospital. The CO of New Zealand 6th Squadron turned up and was most concerned, particularly for Ed, who had suffered 40% burns and needed immediate surgery. They were both evacuated to a fully equipped American hospital on Guadalcanal. Ron eventually recovered to the point where he was evacuated home. Ed writes, "I didn't see Ron again for many years, and by then he was a school principal and senior inspector. Ed was finally given his discharge from Guadalcanal, and once home, he recovered rapidly from his wounds and renewed his dream of climbing Mount Everest. The conquest of Mount Everest in 1953, accompanied by Sherpa Tenzin Norgay, was the first of a string of lifetime achievements. For this, he was knighted the same year by the New Zealand Governor-General Sir Willoughby Norrie. Other achievements during his lifetime included leading a transpolar expedition to the South Pole using the good old Ferguson tractor. Later in his life, he devoted much of his time on philanthropic work, helping the Sherpa people of Nepal. In New Zealand, he served on many organisations dealing with social concerns, and he was appointed High Commissioner to India in 1985. Sir Edmund died in 2008, and seated in the congregation was his old war comrade, Ron Ward MBE. Ron served his life working for the community, much of it as a member of the Rotary Club of Taradale. In 1965, he set up a committee to establish an outdoor education centre at Camp Kaitawa. At the suggestion of the Napier City Council, he organised Rotary Club members and other community groups in planting trees in the Dobell Reserve in Taradale, Napier. This reserve has developed into a popular park area. He was a leading proponent of the Neighbourhood Watch Scheme. For this work, he was rewarded with the Napier Civic Award, and in 1988 he was awarded an MBE. Ron maintained his love of the Catalina and was a member of the New Zealand Catalina Preservation Society until he died in 2014. Ron and Ed were strong personalities who served their communities to the best of their abilities. But they never forgot the time they fought to help each other survive after being burnt and blown into the beautiful warm waters of the Solomon Islands.